Father in heaven, we're thankful for your many blessings. We are grateful for this opportunity to join together to study your words. Bless the communication lines from earth to heaven, from heaven to earth. As we open up your words, grant us wisdom, knowledge, understanding is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
The sun has now set. The day recognized as Thanksgiving in the United States has now ended. And for many, the day was a day celebrated with friends, family, food, fellowship, and unfortunately, frolic and frivolity. In this presentation tonight, we're going to be looking at the origin of Thanksgiving, as well as its connection to the coming National Sunday Law, how it is presently being used today, and also the true Thanksgiving that we are to render to God.
Hillary, as we are sitting here studying God's Word with Safe to Serve International Bible-Believing Christians, we want to take a look at Thanksgiving in the context of the sanctuary, because we believe that God's way is in the sanctuary.
Amen.
So while the whole world just celebrated Thanksgiving Day and they had their feast, they traveled, they all gathered, they ate, this evening we want to focus on the true Thanksgiving through the sanctuary. Now, I hope you have your Bibles, your writing instruments, and your notepads. Take some notes this evening. And let's turn now to the book of Psalm 100. Psalm 100. We're studying here Thanksgiving through the sanctuary. In verse number 4 of Psalm 100, the Bible reads, "Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his holy name." Now, this is sanctuary language. Enter into his gates, enter into his courts.
Mm-hmm.
Sanctuary language here. And notice it says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Now, this does not mean that the sinner, when he walked into the earth, the sanctuary, the temple, the courtyard, enter into his courts, courtyard, that he was simply to say, "Lord, thank you," verbally. But the Bible teaches the sinner was supposed to carry with him a thanksgiving offering. And that's what we want to focus on, the thanksgiving offering. The sanctuary lays out for us. Now, we want to find out, what was this thanksgiving offering? What was entailed in the thanksgiving offering? The first thing you want to write down is this. The thanksgiving offering was also called the peace offering. The peace offering. Now notice in Leviticus chapter 7. Go there with me. Leviticus chapter 7. And let's take a look at verse number 11. Leviticus chapter 7 and verse number 11. Again, write down, the thanksgiving offering was the peace offering. And when we carry to God and give to God the thanksgiving offering, we are indeed making peace with God. Now look with me at verse number 11 of Leviticus chapter 7. Hillary, read that verse for us. Verse 11.
"And this is the law of the sacrifice of peace offerings, which he shall offer unto the Lord."
Verse 12.
"If he offer it for a thanksgiving, then he shall offer with the sacrifice of thanksgiving unleavened cakes mingled with oil and unleavened wafers, anointed with oil, and cakes mingled with oil of fine flour fried."
Now, notice, these verses just laid out for us. The thanksgiving offering was indeed the peace offering. They are connected. Now look at this statement on the screen. From Patriarchs and Prophets, page 576, confirming the relation between the thanksgiving offering and the peace offering. It says here in paragraph 1, it says, Let me skip on down in the middle. It says the sacrifices pointing forward to the death of Christ were designed to preserve in the hearts of the people faith in the Redeemer to come. Hence, it was of the greatest importance that the Lord's directions concerning them should be strictly heeded. Listen to this. The peace offerings were especially an expression of what? Of
thanksgiving
to God. Now go back with me to Leviticus chapter 7. Now notice specifically what comprised the thanksgiving offering. And when the people were making peace with God, they were to bring the emblems that consisted of the thanksgiving offering. In verse number 11 and verse number 12, as you read earlier, Hillary, these verses show us that the thanksgiving offering contained unleavened bread and oil. Now let's begin right here. Let's break this down. Who does the oil represent in Scripture?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse number 13 confirms. So this is the oil, the symbol of the Holy Spirit. And the unleavened bread represented victory over sin. If you remember, when Christ was crucified on Passover, the following day was the Feast of Unleavened Bread. What does unleavened bread mean?
Well, that it wouldn't rise.
The bread would not rise. Christ would not rise. He would remain in the tomb the following day after his crucifixion. The application for us, it represents then that self must be humbled.
Amen.
Self and selfishness, pride, must not be lifted up. Unleavened bread, victory over sin. Write down 1 Corinthians. Go there with me. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. In 1 Corinthians 5, verse number 8, it says this. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. So what is the connection now between the unleavened bread and the oil in the context of thanksgiving? In other words, this represents for us giving God thanks for the Holy Spirit, who will give us power to overcome sin.
Amen. To crucify self and the flesh.
That's it. So as a sinner walked into the gate of the sanctuary, walked into the courts, bringing the oil, bringing the unleavened bread, it was teaching the sinner and others that he or she could thank God in advance for victory over sin, to the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
You know, it's interesting that the oil is mentioned here three times.
Yes.
You know, so it just shows throughout the entire process that we need the Holy Spirit. There's not a single point in our walk, in our steps to Christ, as it were, in our endeavor to achieve victory over sin, where the Holy Spirit is not present. He's there in the beginning and all the way helping us through to get to the final result of victory over sin and our sins eventually to be blotted out.
And this is all done by faith. Go back with me to Leviticus 7. So notice now, enter into his gate with thanksgiving. The thanksgiving offering, long before the sinner will offer anything, the mere carrying of the oil, friends, write it down, the oil, thanking God for the Holy Spirit, the unleavened bread, the Holy Spirit will give us victory over sin. Notice now another application of the thanksgiving offering. And the thanksgiving offering was connected to what other offering?
The peace offering.
Go back to Leviticus 7 with me. In Leviticus chapter 7, look with me now at verse number 29. In verse number 29 through verse number 31. Note it. Verse 29 through verse 31. This was another emblem in the peace offering, thanksgiving offering, which was the sacrificing of an animal.
Hmm.
Thanksgiving and peace offering.
You know, most of the time in American culture, and even Canada has their own celebrations of Thanksgiving and other countries, it's characterized not by sacrifice, but it's characterized by, you know, indulgence of oneself. And so it's interesting here that the Bible is bringing out, as we're going to read in the next verses, that this Thanksgiving offering, there's a sacrifice that is accompanied with it, and we're going to see what that sacrifice is.
Exactly. Notice now, so not indulgence, right?
Correct.
Not
self-denial.
Gluttony, but self-denial. Okay. Amen. Verse 29 through verse 31, the Bible teaches us that the peace offering, Thanksgiving offering, the fat was to be cut out, and the fat was to be burned. Then it says the breast of the animal was also to be cut out and waved before God. So in the Thanksgiving offering, the fat was to be cut out and burned. What would the fat represent for us today?
Sin.
Sin.
Mm-hmm.
So notice, as a sinner would walk into the sanctuary, Thanksgiving offering, he was to also surrender sin.
Hmm.
The fat in this context being cut out and burned. Secondly, the breast was to be cut out and weighed before the Lord. What would the waving of the breast, the chest, the heart represent for us today?
The surrendering of this heart to God, the surrendering of oneself to Christ.
So now notice these four steps now. In the Thanksgiving offering, one, we, the sinners, we, as we come to God, enter into his courts, his gate with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving offering, one, thanking God, the oil, for the Holy Spirit to give us victory over sin, mm-hmm. unleavened bread.
Right.
Not only thanking God for the Holy Spirit to give us victory over sin, but number three now, third step, cutting out the
fat.
Surrendering
That's
of
right.
the sin. Number four, waving the chest, the heart, the breast to God, self-surrender or consecration.
So we see that thanksgiving isn't just some abstract, you know, thanking
no.
God for just anything, but in the context of the sanctuary, which is present truth, which the messengers of God are to dwell upon, it is connected with victory over sin. It's thankfulness by faith that God will give us the victory over sin through the aid and the help of the Holy Spirit.
Now let's take a look at the parable of the Pharisee and the publican, because this context, this parable, this account is in the setting of the Thanksgiving offering. Did you know that? Look at Luke 18 with me. Go there with me. Luke chapter 18. Go there with me. The parable of the publican and the Pharisee is in the context of the Thanksgiving offering. No, notice now, not bringing a literal sacrifice now for us in the last days, but doing those four things as aforementioned.
Mm-hmm.
In Luke chapter 18, look there with me. Luke chapter 18. We see the account of the Pharisee in verse number 11. Now, before you read verse 11, Hillary, let us all remember Psalm 100, verse 4, enter into his courts, enter into his gates with
thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm. How did the Pharisee enter the temple that day?
With well, what? He had thanksgiving.
Let's read that now. Verse number 11, what it says.
The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess.
Now notice, so did he enter the gates with thanksgiving?
Yes. On his lips, yes.
Lip service.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't heart service.
Right.
Did he surrender?
No. He didn't have victory over sin because he has pride here, and he's comparing himself with, you know, others, which
so
we're
now,
told not to do.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Did he cut out the fat?
No.
Did he surrender?
Not at
was
all.
Was pride and selfishness in his heart?
Absolutely.
Yes. So he entered into the gates, the courts, the temple with what? Thanksgiving. It was only lip service.
Hmm.
Are we together so far?
Right. His life was not showing that he was thankful to God.
Didn't bring the offerings.
That's
and
right.
What they typified.
Right.
Notice now, but the publican in verse 13, verse 14, what did he say and what did he do?
Mm-hmm.
Notice now, read that, verse 13.
And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For every one that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted.
So now, did he do anything that was typified in a thanksgiving offering, the peace offering?
Mm-hmm.
Did he surrender?
He did.
Did he confess, God be merciful unto me, a what?
A sinner.
Did he do anything with the breast?
He smote his breast.
God be merciful unto me, a sinner. This man went down to his house how?
Justified.
Justified in the root word is just.
Mm-hmm.
Being at one with God. Did he make peace with God?
He did.
So this is the context of the peace offering. Yet the Pharisee gave God only
lip
service,
not heart service.
And notice now, not only are we looking at this from Bible times, but the Bible says in the last days that God's professed people will only be giving God lip service, not heart service, in the context of the thanksgiving offering. Don't take my words for it. Go to 2 Timothy with me. 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Let's take a look here at verse number 1 and look for that word unthankful. People not giving God thanks, the true thanksgiving offering. Today we don't bring literal oil, literal unleavened bread, nor do we bring an animal sacrifice, but we bring to God what those emblems represent today. Amen?
Amen. And it's interesting that the thanksgiving offering was offered daily. This was one of the daily sacrifices that had to be made.
Potent.
Not once a year.
You're preaching.
Daily.
Potent point. Potent point. Mm-hmm. Look with me. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Read verse 1 for us, Hillary.
This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy.
Notice now. So in the last days, church, how are they identified?
Unthankful.
And characterized?
Unthankful.
As being unthankful. Notice now, in the context of the sanctuary, this is not just being unthankful, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's showing they do not bring to God now the applications of the typical emblems in a thanksgiving offering. And verse number 5 now says that they have a form
of godliness.
But denying the power thereof, from such turn away, just like the Pharisee.
That's right.
Giving God only lip service, having a form of godliness, just like those professed people of God in the last days.
That's right. But it's interesting that as I look at it, unthankful, unholy, I don't think it's by coincidence that those two are mentioned together. One precedes the other. If you're unthankful, how are you going to be declared in the judgment? Because we have to put this in the context of the sanctuary, the judgment. And if Revelation 22 says that when Christ comes, after the investigative judgment, some are going to be pronounced holy, just, while others are going to be pronounced unjust and unholy still. So if we are manifesting unthankfulness by refusing to surrender our lives to God, the final declaration upon our cases is going to be, he that is unjust, he that is unholy, remain so. But it's interesting, as we brought this out, Cain also, he brought an offering to God as well. His offering was not accepted, but he brought a thank offering. However, he did not accompany that thank offering with a sacrifice. He did not accompany it with repentance, with sorrow for sin. And we see that the thanksgiving offering does not stand alone. We cannot be thankful until we first have that mourning, that sorrow for sin. That precedes the thanksgiving offering. If we haven't had that experience, what really are we thankful for?
And let's put that point in a sure place. In addition to that, what would cause a sinner to come to the sanctuary in past times? He must have been convicted.
Right.
Having sorrow for sin.
And that's the oil, the Holy Spirit.
To come to the sanctuary, mm-hmm. to give God thanks that God would convict his heart, to lead him to repentance. And when he comes, he doesn't come with just lip service. He brings the emblems. And so when we come to God, we have to bring the experience that those emblems represent. And look now at Christ's object lessons. Page 152. Listen what was stated concerning the experience, the account of Cain. Giving God only lip service, but not true surrendering of sin. Look what this is, Hillary, the Pharisee.
The Pharisee and the publican represent two great classes into which those who come to worship God are divided. Their first two representatives are found in the first two children that were born into the world. Cain thought himself righteous, and he came to God with a thank offering only. Mm. He made no confession of sin and acknowledged no need of mercy.
But Abel.
But Abel came with the blood that pointed to the Lamb of God. He came as a sinner, confessing himself lost. His only hope was the unmerited love of God. The Lord had respect to his offering, but to Cain and his offering, he had not respect.
Now, let's go back to scripture on this one, right? Mm-hmm. Let's go to Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4, it's all in the context of the thanksgiving offering. That means Cain gave God only lip service.
Right.
God did not reject Cain because he brought the fruits. No. Because God gave instructions to bring fruits. But the fruits was not what he required first.
Right.
It's the surrendering of the heart.
And the animal sacrifice, yes. pointing toward that he believed yes. in the Messiah to come, who would be the one to give them the victory.
And as he surrendered, mm-hmm. cutting out the fat, surrendering of sin, then he could thank God for the victory in advance. In Genesis chapter 4, just putting things in its right perspective, in its chronological and sequential order. Now we know the story. Verse number 3, Cain brought fruit. Mm-hmm. If you write down Leviticus 19 and verse 24, the fruit offering represented thanks and praise. Thanksgiving, but he did not surrender. Look at verse number 4. It says, and Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the what? And
the
of the
fat
thereof. Mm. He only gave God lip service. And when we surrender our hearts to God, then we can thank God for victory. Look at this scripture. Go to Romans with me. Romans.
Pastor, can I quickly bring out a point while yes. we're going there? We know
Romans
that Cain and Abel were brothers. And we're going to show where this unthankfulness is tending. He brought the thanksgiving offering without the sacrifice. He did not surrender his heart to God.
I see what you're
Then when Abel went to talk to him and, you know, try to convince him to bring what God required of him, his anger rose up. God didn't accept his offering. He didn't want to hear it from Abel. What happened? He became a persecutor of his brother. And so it is. Those professed Christians, professed Seventh-day Adventists, we can even say, who are not surrendering their hearts to God, they're going to become the bitterest enemies of those who are presenting the thank offering to God. And furthermore, Abel reproved him. He rebuked him for not giving God what he should. So Cain represents that class of Seventh-day Adventists who are not surrendered, who are not receiving victory over sin, and because others are and are trying to point them in the way of Christ and pointing out their error, what did he do to Abel?
That's it.
He slew his brother. So we have to see where this is leading.
If we just give God lip service, not heart service, we are going to be the persecutors of the faithful. Now, let's hold Romans 7. Go to Romans chapter 1. Since you brought up the point, Hillary, about where this is tending, mm-hmm. those who do not give God the true thanksgiving offering, those four steps again, thanking God for the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. who can give them victory over sin, unleavened bread.
Over self.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And also, cutting out the flesh, surrendering every known sin. And number four, consecration. If those professed Christians do not give God the true thanksgiving offering, those four steps, the Bible tells us God is going to give them over to a reprobate mind.
Wow.
That they are going to be persecutors. They are going to be a part of the LGBT movement. They are going to be even those who hate and despise those who are living for God. Look at Romans chapter 1 with me. In Romans chapter 1, look at verse 21. In the context of the thanksgiving offering, those who do not follow those four steps, the emblems and what they represent, the Bible calls them unthankful. They're not thankful. They're unthankful. Don't give God a thanksgiving offering. They are going to be a part of the LGBT movement. Romans chapter 1. Here we go ahead. Verse 21, what it says.
Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened.
Pause right there. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
So because they knew God, they glorified him
not
as God. They did not glorify him. I wonder what that means. And number two, as they did not glorify God, they did not give him
the thanksgiving offering.
They were not thankful. Verse 22. Now, let's stop right there. Because which message mentions giving God glory?
The first angel.
So that means those who reject the principles of the first angel's message of chapter 14 of Revelation, verse 6 and verse 7, they are not thankful to God. They are unthankful. They are not giving God the thanksgiving offering. Those four steps. What happens to them now? It says in verse 26, Hillary.
For this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet.
Now, are these the only sins that people will partake of because they do not give God a thanksgiving offering, those four steps? No, because verse number 28, God gives them over to a reprobate mind. Verse 29, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, backbiters, disobedient to parents without understanding. Notice, disobedient to parents.
Right.
Just as in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 and verse 2, disobeying their parents, becoming unthankful
and unholy.
And now in Romans chapter 1, God gives them over woman with woman, men with men, working that which is against nature. Now, are we seeing this in the church today?
Unfortunately,
look,
we are.
All of the Protestant churches, apostate Protestant churches, those in Babylon, it's because they have rejected the principles laid out in a thanksgiving offering, the peace offering. Unfortunately, it's right here within the Seventh-day Adventist denomination. Look at this article here on Spectrum. November 15th, 2016. The headline reads, Adventist Chaplain Terry Rice waits indefinitely for the church to endorse him. For church endorsement. Skip on down. It says, I have been, Terry Rice speaking, I've been a healthcare chaplain since 2008. And before that, I was a chaplain, Bible teacher in the Seventh-day Adventist academies. After I came out as gay, I moved from the educational setting to the healthcare setting, where I minister to hospice patients, their families, and our own staff as they desire. It's going on right now. Mm. Next slide. Now, friends, before I read on, looking at these things, let's move away from the noise, and let's really look at and listen to what Terry Rice stated, as he is a gay chaplain and a Seventh-day Adventist. Listen to his words very carefully as he implicates Seventh-day Adventist administrators and pastors, stating that they believe that his lifestyle is okay in the sight of God. That being gay and Seventh-day Adventist is okay.
And holding a position. And holding a position.
And holding a position in the church. Not my words. Listen to what he said. He says here, Hillary, go ahead. Last August,
I went to support my chaplain colleague, Jackie Kress, who was being ordained or commissioned at an Adventist hospital in town. The North American Division team performing the service took me aside. I was told that my endorsement is in process. When I asked for how long, the answer was indefinitely, and that I had no choice but to wait.
Friend, what does that mean? We don't even have to go too deep. What does that one statement mean?
I don't know if I'm going to answer your question, but what caught my attention is just the connectivity between the women's ordination movement and the gay movement.
All right. All right. Look at this
even
one.
Even he can link it.
Yes. Look at this one. Here is a question to Terry Rice. Is there any chance that the division, North American division, could change its mind and decide to allow you to be endorsed, meaning ordained? Is there a specific person or committee that is responsible for the decision? Listen to his answer. Hillary?
I'm told by both retired and current Adventist chaplaincy ministries members that people don't want to vote against the person stonewalling me, as he has lots of political influence in the NAD, and my career is stuck in this political game indefinitely.
What is that statement saying? How many people did he say is prohibiting him from being ordained as a gay Seventh-day Adventist chaplain, teacher among us? Who? How many persons?
The person.
One.
The person.
So what is he implying here?
That others accept it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's make it very, very clear that this is not our private interpretation. Look at this. Next paragraph. Here comes a question. How and when do you think the church's attitude toward gay members might change? Here is Terry Rice's response. Hillary.
It will never change in my lifetime if we keep a need for a global consensus to bless what we say and do locally. In North America, it has changed for the better over the years. A few more Adventist churches are becoming not only welcoming, but also affirming.
Wow. What does that mean?
Wow.
So he's saying the North American division has been changing for the better over the years in accepting practicing LGBT individuals to become leaders in the church. Elders, chaplains, preachers, teachers. Now, how has the NAD been changing over the years? Look at this. You have another chaplain. His name is Jonathan Henderson, preaching a few months ago that nothing is wrong with Adam and Steve relationship, sexual. And now we have the 21-page document from Andrews University the North American Division of Seventh-day Adventists, the Biblical Research Institute, the Lake Union Conference. We are seeing when you combine all these things together, the big picture. Mm-hmm. Look at this. Then we have, watch carefully, in that 21-page document, the bottom paragraph says, all persons, including who? Practicing homosexuals should be made to feel welcome to attend our churches, while non-practicing gay persons should be welcomed into membership.
Wow.
And church office. And Terry Rice said that there's only one person hindering him from being ordained. That means he's saying, implying other leaders within Seventh-day Adventism, they are okay with him being ordained.
Wow.
And yet when they came out with the 21-page document, they were saying, oh, Pastor Henriquez, you are just a mere alarmist. That's not what they are promoting. We are seeing it right now.
That's right.
Look at this. In the same document, let's keep on down to the bottom paragraph. What is the last, read that, Hillary, gay and lesbian members.
Gay and lesbian members who choose to and remain abstinent should be given the opportunity to participate in all church activities, including leadership positions in the church. We strongly affirm that homosexual persons have a place in the Seventh-day Adventist church. Why call themselves homosexual if they're not practicing?
Okay. And then we have on Seventh-day Adventist campuses all throughout North American Division. Here's one, Walla Walla University. Just the last phrase, it says, the conversation is not a new one, but the need to create safe environments for LGBT members, don't forget that, in churches and schools cannot be muted. Move on. Here we have just a quick review on these campuses within Seventh-day Adventism. You have these.
Yeah, gay clubs.
Mm-hmm. Clubs for LGBT lifestyle and its movement. And then from the Netherlands Conference stating that we commit ourselves to make the LGBTI individuals feel safe in our churches.
Wow.
As if somebody is going to arm wrestle and crucify them.
You know, this is interesting because all of these that you're showing are recent, are fairly recent, within perhaps 2 years, even a year. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Sister White has a statement where she says that the Sunday Law movement is making its way in darkness. Well, the same cannot be said of this movement here. It's not in darkness. It's in full force. It's making its way out in the open. It can't be concealed.
Potent point here. You're preaching now. Potent, potent. Look at this. And then we saw just a few months ago, they're in Hollywood, California, the Hollywood Seventh-day, well, they call it Hollywood Seventh-day Adventist Church. The first transgender SDA elder,
wow,
quoting the man who called himself Rhonda, stating, it's very obvious that this is a loving church. This is a church that does not care about your religious beliefs.
Wow.
All those things don't matter.
Hmm.
Move on. And then we had just a few months ago, the Palm Springs Gay Men's Chorus was invited, and they attended, sang, and ministered to the Palm Springs Seventh-day Adventist Church under whose leadership? Pastor Michael Leno.
I wonder what spirit they ministered to the people.
And then, no friends, look at this Facebook. Someone sent me this, the Facebook site of Palm Springs Adventist Church, the very same one who invited the all-men's gay chorus to sing just last year, December. Look at the thread. The last one is Palm Springs Adventist Church answering. It says, the answer is no to all those specific questions. We did invite a gay chorus to sing once for a special Christmas program. Palm Springs has a large gay community, and some are Adventists.
Wow. Unbelievable.
Orphans. Did you get that?
Yeah.
So the pastor, the leaders are acknowledging that among them holding membership are people who are gay, homosexuals, lesbians. They are literally acknowledging it.
Wow.
Look at this, friends. Back to Terry Rice. Let's make sure this is not our private interpretation. The question is to Terry Rice, what is there about the Adventist church that makes you feel hopeful? Hillary?
I know of many Adventist pastors, many, who tell me privately that my orientation is a beautiful expression of God's diverse creation. It starts with humbly learning God's love and realizing sola scriptura doesn't mean sola hermeneutics.
Did you get that?
Wow.
Did you get that, friends?
Wow. This is really unbelievable.
Now, someone may say, oh, you are just criticizing the church. But let me ask you a question. Do you think God wants us to be silent when publicly men are defaming God's character? God's character is on the line. And by God's grace, we cannot be found indifferent or neutral when we're living now in a time of religious crisis. If a stranger out there, God is moving upon his heart, her heart, to join the Seventh-day Adventist movement, and they are running from the sins of Sodom, the sins of Egypt, atheism, would they come to this church, local churches? But they profess to be Seventh-day Adventists. They would say, since your church is in my community, maybe all the other churches believe the same.
Wow.
Somebody has to say no. There are faithful Seventh-day Adventists who believe what Scripture says, and they do not just sit in a corner and say, oh, look at what's happening. No, they lift their voices and call sin by its right name.
That's right.
Let's get back. So notice now, what brought us here? Romans chapter 1, those who don't glorify God or don't give God thanksgiving, giving him the thanksgiving offering, the four steps, thanking God for the Holy Spirit to give them victory over sin.
Right.
Cutting out the fat. First saying, this lifestyle is sinful based on Scripture.
Right.
And then consecrating your life to God. Go to Romans 7 with me. Romans chapter 7. The first thing is acknowledgement. Romans chapter 7. Let's read this promise of thanksgiving. Look at verse 25. Verse 25. You know, friends, if you go back and you read this article written by Terry Rice, this interview on Spectrum, he says, what sin have I committed? Nothing is wrong with my lifestyle. And he wants to be ordained.
And the pastors, I mean, they're those that are encouraging him in private conversations.
He says, I know of many.
Yeah.
So friends, either we must take him at his word or he's telling a story.
Right. So they're basically saying, like he's saying, that you don't have to, you haven't committed a sin. It's beautiful, and a beautiful expression. That's blasphemy.
No,
that's an abomination.
A beautiful expression of God's diverse creation. Wait a minute. God made man and woman in his image, his likeness, not Adam and Steve.
Right.
Oh, friend.
That's right.
It's blasphemy.
And if these pastors believe that, they're not offering the thank offering either, because which is connected with victory over sin. If they're telling people you don't have to get victory over this lifestyle, you can remain practicing and still be saved.
And one reason why I believe that Terry Rice is not telling a story is the other evidences within Adventism.
Correct.
That we have shown, and there are many, many more. So we know this is not a he's not lying, friends.
These are just the public ones. What you shared were just the public ones.
Romans chapter 7, verse 25. You can note that. Why did Paul thank God?
For victory.
Victory over sin, to obey God's law. Go to Romans 6. Mm-hmm. Romans chapter 6, and look at verse 17. He says this in verse 17, but God be thanked that you were the servants, that's past tense, you were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you.
Amen.
This is thanking God for victory. Go back to Leviticus 7 with me. Now, friends, note this on your paper. In Leviticus chapter 7, the thanksgiving offering was akin to the Passover. Note that. The very instructions that were given in the thanksgiving offering, peace offering, was also given for the Passover. Leviticus chapter 7, and friends, where we're going is to make the connection now between the thanksgiving offering from the sanctuary and the coming Sunday law crisis. That's where we're going. Look at the screen here. From Thanksgiving to Sunday. That's where we're going right now. Leviticus chapter 7. Let's take a look at verse 15. Hillary, read that for us. The connection between Thanksgiving offering and the Passover. Verse 15. Hillary.
And the flesh of the sacrifice of his peace offerings for thanksgiving shall be eaten the same day that it is offered. He shall not leave any of it until the morning.
So when must it be eaten? The same?
The same evening.
And none must be left until when?
Until the morning.
Okay. Taking that point, thanksgiving offering, go now to Exodus 12. Exodus chapter 12. And look with me now at verse number 20. The same instructions were given for the Passover. Exodus 12, look at verse 10. Verse 10. Hillary, read that for us.
Okay. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning. And that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire.
So we see the connection there between thanksgiving offering and the Passover. Eat it. Let nothing remain until the morning. When, who fulfilled the Passover service? Jesus.
Christ.
Go now to Matthew 26. Go there now. Matthew 26, we are building now, showing us the connection between the thanksgiving offering and the coming mark of the beast crisis. Matthew 26. Look here now at verse number 24. It says this of Matthew 26 and verse number 24. It says this, the Son of Man. Pardon me. Go down to verse number 26. Verse 26, Matthew 26. He says, and as they were eating, who, friends? Jesus took bread and blessed it and break it and gave it to the disciples and said, what now?
Take
and what?
Eat.
This is my
body.
And verse 27. He says he gave thanks. In verse 27,
yes.
The thanksgiving offering in practice, not just in theory, but in practice.
Amen.
Eat all of it. Now, what was the content? Who was coming to persecute Jesus in the context of him giving thanks for the emblem, the symbol that represented his broken body? Who and who were joining now to crucify Jesus?
The Jews and the Romans.
Church and state. Church and state in the context of Christ giving thanks, the thanks offering, thanking him for victory, the plan of salvation. Verse 24 mentions the crisis. Now, are we seeing events showing us the mark of the beast is near?
Yes.
Watch this carefully. Go with me. Chapter 13 of the Revelation. Are we seeing signs showing us the mark of the beast is near?
Absolutely.
You know, friends, now I'm going to invite the young evangelists, Jared and Jeff, to join us here on the set. Because they have been going out and we have been sharing with the community, asking them various questions, and then sharing with them gospel literature, present truth literature, to awaken their minds to the coming crisis. And in chapter 13 of Revelation, verse number 11 speaks about the United States in prophecy. These two horns like a lamb, but America will one day speak as a dragon. In other words, she will repudiate those two horns and what they represent. And these two horns represent religious freedom and civil freedom, but America will speak as a dragon. The dragon represents, in one sense, persecution. Chapter 12 and verse 17 tells us, the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, they that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And we're told in this statement, volume 5 of the testimonies, page 451. Now, most of us know the statement. Just focus in the middle section. It says, when Protestantism joined hands with the Roman power and clasped hands with spiritualism, then it says, when under the influence of the threefold union, our country shall repudiate every principle of its constitution as a Protestant and Republican government. And once they begin to repudiate our freedom, the next step, this country shall make provision for the propagation of papal falsehoods and delusions. Then we may know the time has come for the marvelous working of Satan, and that the end is near. Now, Jeff, Jared, both of you, we're all on the field daily.
Right.
What are we seeing? What events show us the end is here? Talk to us.
Now, on that point that you just read, that the United States is going to repudiate every principle of the Constitution, we're seeing that taking place. We went into the field and we did some interviews based on Facebook and Google, how they are under criticism for failing to prevent the spread of fake news. And we interviewed the people, and we're going to show you some of the responses of what they had to say.
All right. Look at it right now.
So, John, how often do you use Google, Facebook, and YouTube to get information?
I use Google daily, Facebook a couple times a week, and I usually don't really use YouTube for information that much.
Well, according to Time.com, Facebook and Google are under criticism for failing to prevent the spread of fake news by alternative news media.
So, do you know of any alternative media sources?
I mean, there's plenty of, like, source material that you could search through. I get my news from NPR, I get my news from PBS, I get my news from other sites that are not social media driven. Those are not first-hand sources. They haven't been through the editorial process, so you don't know if that information that you're reading is correct, and a lot of people just will read something that's popped up on their feed and assume it's correct, but there are other sources. I mean, ABC, CNN, BBC World, you can get world news online. Just vet your own resources, do your own research before you believe something, because, I mean, that has an effect, so.
Yeah, so alternative media are sources that are not your traditional media sources, as you name some traditional ones, NPR, ABC, Fox, so on and so forth.
Now, do you know why Facebook and Google are under attack for failing to prevent the spread of fake news?
Well, I do. In the case of Facebook, you know, people can put on whatever they put on, and it is misinterpreted as truth. It's part of the post-truth phenomenon, right?
Yes, and critics are actually saying that alternative news media has influenced the presidential debate, and this is why Donald Trump is president-elect.
No question.
Now, what are your thoughts on that?
There's no question about it.
So you would agree that that is why Donald Trump won the presidency?
Yeah, there's no way otherwise that that person could possibly get elected.
Now, do you know what President Obama said regarding Facebook and Google on this matter?
I have no idea.
Okay, so according to Time magazine, President Obama stated that fake news, he calls it conspiracy theories and propaganda that is just packaged as news. And he also said that it threatens our democratic freedoms. So do you think that we need to get rid of these alternative media sources and just use the traditional media sources such as CNN, Yahoo, MSNBC?
Well, I think that's a touchy subject when you start talking about policing what people can post or what information people can share. One of the pillars of this country is the establishment of freedom of the press and freedom to speak one's mind. And if you start telling people that they can't do that, then I think you're compromising the Constitution of the United States, and I'm not for that at all. Now, whether or not you want to police news outlets and make them actually fact check, those situations are already already in place. You know, we've got slander laws and defamation laws specifically to address that. So no, I don't think you should be able to police what's posted on Facebook necessarily.
Now, Jana, do you think that we need to get rid of alternative news media and make traditional news sites the only source of news?
If that is possible, I think that that would be a great idea. I mean, we all have a freedom of speech, so I'm not sure how that's going to go. But I definitely think that if you could do away with them, that would be great. If you can't, I definitely think that people should be doing their research and deciding if it's a legitimate source or not. Like I said, when I do that, I also not only look for what's on their site, but then I see if things like, or if media outlets like CNN have carried it, or something that I know is a legitimate source.
Now, Jarrett, what happens in countries when the government is the only person that controls the news media sources?
Yeah, I think that that's a slippery slope. I think it's risky because then the government can just really almost brainwash people into thinking whatever it is that is in their agenda. So having, you know, bipartisan, having, you know, news outlets that are not influenced in, or biased in one way or the other, I think is really important.
Now, are you aware of the freedoms given to us in the First Amendment of the Constitution?
I believe I am, yes.
And what are those freedoms?
Freedom of speech, freedom of press. No, is press one of the other amendments?
No, freedom of press is in there, the freedom of speech, freedom to assemble peacefully, and also freedom of religion. Now, if there's an attack on freedom of press, then it would also be an attack on freedom of speech and freedom of religion. So, Jana, are you aware that the Bible prophesies that our freedoms will be taken away from us here in America?
Yes, I definitely am aware of that part of the prophecy.
And yes, this can be found in the Bible in the book of Revelation, chapter 13. What we're going to do is actually give you an article that speaks more on this topic, as well as some literature that shows how history is being repeated. Is there anything else you would like to add?
Well, I definitely appreciate the information, and I definitely agree on so many levels. That I believe prophecy is coming true in this time. I never thought I'd live to see it, but here we are, and I just hope for a positive outcome.
All right, well, thank you so much, Jana, for your time. Thank you.
Now, as we were on the field, we gathered a few points from the people.
Yeah.
And we can see the obvious state of the world as well as the government. Now, there was a young woman named Jana. And Jana said that after being asked, do you think that we need to get rid of an alternative media? She said we should. But also, her own words, she said there might be an issue, of course, with our First Amendment rights.
Now, it was interesting on that point because based on her response, she represents a large class of people that want all these alternative media sites to be taken away. And she's not really afraid of our First Amendment rights being taken away. She represents a large class of people. And at this time, we are seeing how our First Amendment rights are being stripped away, and no one is saying anything. We were just talking about Facebook and Google. But recently, in recent news, Facebook and Google were also in the news for now trying to stop hate speech. And we know that they're trying to stop the hate speech. And all of the interviews that we do, they're in light of the great controversy. So that's the only way we can look at this. Who are the people that are going to be labeled as speaking hate? It's going to be God's professed people.
And not only that, another point we gathered on the field was what from a man. He said specifically that Fox News is nothing but entertainment. It wasn't in this clip, but he mentioned it. You saw the man who said that because of alternative media, that's why Donald Trump won. He said Fox News is nothing but entertainment. But I want to go a step even further. It's mainstream media that is entertainment. Not only that, they have a specific agenda, and we know what that agenda is. Throughout the election, we saw how the mainstream media, especially CNN, was pushing for the win for Hillary Clinton.
That's true.
Not only that, the mainstream media, they are for what happened in June of 2015, and we know what that was. It was legalized licentiousness. So we see this going on. We see that the mainstream media has this agenda for a liberal right, you know, the liberal wing. But not only that, we see quite recently there was a list compiled telling us what fake news actually is. And some of the news outlets that were included was Breitbart and IG Review. Now, IG Review is no longer on there, but there's Breitbart. Now, if you're familiar with these news outlets, we know that these are what?
Conservative
news outlets. So what do we see going on here? What we see is the liberals, people who are promoting licentiousness, pushing against the conservative side. Now, this reminds me of Daniel chapter 11 and verse 40. And we know what that says. We see as the king of the south is pushing against the king of the north. But the Bible lets us know what is coming soon. What's going to happen? The king of the north is going to come back like a whirlwind.
Now, what was interesting, as we were in the field, all we had to say was the term alternative media.
Yes.
And everyone was talking about CNN, Yahoo, MSNBC, those as credible sites, saying, you know, don't listen. I don't go on Facebook for news, you know, pretty much stating almost everything on Facebook is fake. I go on CNN, MSNBC. And the connection here is that we asked, what happens in a government when all of the media is controlled by the government? We know the result is what? It's a
communist.
A communist. It's a dictatorship.
Yeah. Mind control of the
mind
people.
Control. Mm-hmm. And when that happens, we know that the government has control over the people. Now, even today, you could say, because there is alternative media, that the government is not a dictatorship. It doesn't have control. But what do they have to do? All they have to do is begin to slander alternative media.
In general. Okay.
And by slandering alternative media, then now, as they put their propaganda on CNN, MSNBC, people are going to take that as factual. Mm-hmm. So by slandering all, they're really targeting the group of people that they want.
Potent point. Yes.
And that those people,
that's
of
it.
Course, Revelation 12, it says, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
So all we can do at this time is take the words of Sister White as she says, get ready,
get ready,
get ready, get ready, because it is coming to God's people.
Amen.
Powerful. All right. Thanks to Jeff and Jared for joining us and sharing with us the word. And we have to keep marching on, because what I saw in the video clip are people who were hungry to receive the truth. And many of them are seeing things.
That's right.
And now they're saying, wow, other people can see what I'm seeing, that government is intruding on our freedoms. And they can tell something catastrophic is coming, but they don't know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
See, we have to connect the dots.
We have to be the light bearers
for them. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you.
All
thank
right.
you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. So friends, you heard it from Jeff and Jared.
Well, another way in which we see that our civil and religious freedoms are being infringed upon and even threatened is by the declaration of presidents and other government officials declaring a day as holy or as a national feast day, such as Thanksgiving. Now, we're going to take this time to look at the brief history of Thanksgiving before we show the connection between the observance of Thanksgiving and the proclamation of Thanksgiving by the presidents every year and how that lines up with the Sunday law, the mark of the beast crisis. But we're just going to take a brief look at the history and the origin of Thanksgiving, because a lot of people don't really know the history of Thanksgiving, and they celebrated unknowing where it came from. As the story goes, in 1621, you know, the pilgrims gathered in Plymouth, Massachusetts, and they held this big feast of Thanksgiving to God and so forth. But I'm going to read a couple of statements that are verifiable in history. If you do your own research, it can be verified, that show that Thanksgiving originates long before this first celebration of Thanksgiving. And so we're going to see here that it is a syncretism. It's cultural and religious syncretism, which basically means a merging or an amalgamation of paganism with religion.
Yes.
So I'm just going to read. It says, the bulk of traditions associated with Thanksgiving come from pagan harvest celebrations that originated in England, okay, known as the Harvest Festival in England.
Don't forget that, in England.
Okay. They're sometimes known as, like I said, the Harvest Festival, Harvest Home, or Harvest Thanksgiving. Okay, well, the pagan rituals and symbolism of harvest celebrations in which the gods of vegetation or the gods of agriculture were worshipped, I guess, for providing the people with abundance of food, they were combined over time with religious observances of days of Thanksgiving that were practiced in the Church of England. Now, I want us to take notice of this this picture behind us. What is this basket known as? What's the name that we call this basket with food and vegetables and fruits coming out of it? It's known as a cornucopia. Well, not too many people know that the cornucopia is connected with Greek and Roman mythology.
Yes.
It's Latin for the horn of plenty, and it's used to worship the gods of in Greek and Roman mythology, as said before.
If you do the research, there are some banks that have this as your emblem,
mm-hmm.
cornucopia, yes, and also various secret societies use, again, secret societies also use the cornucopia as their logo.
So we have to be careful what things we adopt in our homes and in our lifestyle, because we need to know where they're coming from and why. But Harvest Thanksgiving was an annual celebration during the harvest season or the autumn season. But also religious thanksgivings were set aside at any time of the year. Eventually, as said before, these two, the pagan harvest celebrations, which were celebrated annually, and the religious Thanksgiving services were blended into one. It was merged into a single autumn holiday or autumn celebration, which combined the religious worship services, large family gathering, dances, and a large meal. Okay, and I'll read how it came to America or how it's observed in America. It says, Thanksgiving Day is fixed by a proclamation of the president and governors of the states. The president's proclamation makes the day a legal holiday. Very important. In 1789, the Episcopal Church formally recognized the civil government's authority to appoint such a feast. And
who?
The Episcopal Church.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Don't forget that.
And in 1888, the Roman Catholic Church also decided to honor a festival which had long been nearly universally observed. That's taken from the Encyclopedia Americana. You can look it up yourself. But the year 1888 caught my attention, because we know in the year 1888 the Sunday Blair Bill was introduced, which almost brought the National Sunday Law to America. And it's interesting that Thanksgiving was adopted that very year in 1888 by the Roman Catholic Church. And with all other Catholic holidays, they just took a pagan day that was already observed, they Christianized it to facilitate the nominal acceptance of Catholicism by pagans, and then they called it a religious festival. So it was with the Thanksgiving holiday.
Now, two things. One, when we read in the Spirit of Prophecy regarding Thanksgiving, you see that we are to use that day for evangelistic purposes, period. All right? Now notice, when you understand that, then you know how to deal with Thanksgiving and other national holidays, holy days, right? Secondly, because the day is so widely celebrated, we cannot ignore it. but we can use it as a way of evangelism. Secondly, we are not here this evening to tell you what to do, whether to celebrate or not to celebrate Thanksgiving, right? That is your decision to make. This section of the study is to show you, just as the civil government can legalize and proclaim Thanksgiving, which is a day that is a blending of paganism and Christianity, we must see in that the proclamation of the Sunday law crisis, which is again a blending of paganism and Christianity. Don't take my words for it. Let's go back into our history books, because we're told we have nothing to fear for the future. Life Sketches 196. Except we forget the way how God has led us and his teachings in our past history. We have nothing to fear for the future except we forget. Look at this. Look at the statement here on the screen. From a Seventh-day Adventist pioneer, Alonzo Trevier Jones, A.T. Jones, also a church historian. He says this, Hillary?
The time for the usual annual Thanksgiving Day of the American people is approaching, and undoubtedly the president will issue the usual Thanksgiving proclamation.
Now look at this other slide, and Obama did so today. Look at these words, pardon me, yesterday. Look at these words. Therefore, I, Barack Obama, and it goes on, it goes on, it goes on, do hereby proclaim November 24, 2016 as a national day of Thanksgiving. Look at these words. I encourage the people. That sounds innocent, but you are going to see that is not an innocent statement. I encourage the people of the United States to join together, whether in our homes and where else, places of worship. Now let's go back to A.T. Jones. He says this after the first statement. This is a reminder of the manner in which principles, so when the president issues the usual Thanksgiving proclamation, he says, this is a reminder of the manner in which principles are trodden underfoot, and how a wrong by custom may become a matter of course and soon be considered as entirely legitimate and right. The drafters of each of our greatest political documents, such as the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution of the U.S., were radically opposed to this deviation from American principles. So he's telling us that the founding fathers, that most of them were radically opposed for a president to proclaim a day of feast, Thanksgiving, a day of fast, etc. They were opposed to this. Look at this statement. Then he quotes, how many of you knew this? Look at this quote now. Then A.T. Jones quoted from Madison, James Madison. Now, in the context of proclaiming a national feast, even Thanksgiving, this is from the National Archives. Hillary, that one sentence, what it says there.
There has been another deviation from the strict principle in the executive proclamations of fasts and festivals.
That's it right there. Now listen to how he quotes Thomas Jefferson, the third U.S. president. This is Jefferson speaking about Thanksgiving. How many of you knew what I'm about to read? It says this, the Baptist address. The who?
Baptist.
Let's see who were the ones behind the scene pressuring Thomas Jefferson, saying it's okay to proclaim the National Thanksgiving Day. It says here, the Baptist address, now enclosed, said Thomas Jefferson, admits of a condemnation of the alliance between church and state under the authority of the U.S. Constitution. It furnishes an occasion too, which I have long wished to find, of saying why I, Thomas Jefferson, do not proclaim fastings and thanksgivings as my predecessors did. Did you get that? Sir Thomas Jefferson said to proclaim a national Thanksgiving Day was a union of what?
Church and state.
And state. How many of you knew that? Let's read on. He says, I know it will give great offense to whom? The New England clergy. You see how the history connects? But the advocate, listen, but the advocate, so we can see who was behind the scenes pressuring Thomas Jefferson to say, go ahead, it's okay to proclaim Thanksgiving Day as a national holiday or holy day. It says the Church of England, Episcopalians, and also the Baptists. And in 1888, we saw that the Roman Catholics were also behind the scenes. Let's go back. What Thomas Jefferson said, last sentence, but the advocate of religious freedom is to expect neither what?
Peace
nor forgiveness from them.
Wow.
So as a president, he would stand up against the idea of proclaiming Thanksgiving Day, because he said it was an alliance between church and state, which was unconstitutional. How many of you knew that?
Would this also implicate the national days of prayer that they appoint?
Especially this year, we have seen a number of them. National days of prayer. It's a union of church and state. Notice now, this is, again, A.T. Jones, and he quoted from Thomas Jefferson. I went back to the original source. Hillary, read this for us.
I'm aware that the practice of my predecessors may be quoted, but I...
Wait a minute, saying what? But Thomas Jefferson, George Washington gave the proclamation for National Thanksgiving Day. You must also follow him. That's the context. Go ahead.
I think it started with Lincoln, but I have ever believed that the example of state executives led to the assumption of that authority by the general government without due examination, which would have discovered that what might be a right in a state government was a violation of that right when assumed by another. Be this as it may, everyone must act according to the dictates of his own reason.
And mine.
And mine tells me that civil powers alone have been given to the President of the U.S. and no authority to direct the religious exercises of his constituents.
Is that point clear? Look
very
at this.
Clear.
He says this. This is from the Library of Congress. Hillary. It says, but it is only proposed that I, Thomas Jefferson, should recommend, not prescribe, a day of fasting and prayer. What was he saying there? Many were saying, oh, Thomas Jefferson, just do it. It's just a recommendation.
It's just encouraging
That's
people.
That's what Obama said. I encourage you.
You
saw it. Amen. Oh, it's just a recommendation. But Thomas Jefferson said, even a mere recommendation for proclaiming Thanksgiving Day was unconstitutional. It was an alliance of what? Church and state. He says, but it is only proposed. Go ahead, Aaron, that I should.
That I should recommend, not prescribe, a day of fasting and prayer. That is, that I should indirectly assume to the United States an authority over religious exercises, which the Constitution has directly precluded them from. It must be meant, too, that this recommendation is to carry some authority and to be sanctioned by some penalty on those who disregard it, not indeed of fine and imprisonment, but of some degree of proscription, perhaps in public opinion.
What is that saying there?
Public shaming, basically.
Exactly. So he's saying, even if the executive branch of government, the White House, president, proclaim a Thanksgiving Day, he says, with that recommendation that there is going to be some penalty for those who disregard it. He says, maybe not
fines
or imprisonment, but some degree of proscription, perhaps public shame. Now, does that sound like one step to the Sunday law crisis? Because when that is executed, proclaimed by the civil government, Congress, the judicial arm, and the executive branch, What will happen to those who disregard the Sunday law?
Right.
Fines and imprisonment, even death.
That's right.
Yep. A connection here. Read on.
And does the change in the nature of the penalty make the recommendation less a law of conduct for those to whom it is directed? I do not believe it is for the interest of religion to invite the civil magistrate to direct its exercises, its discipline, or its doctrines, nor of the religious societies that the general government should be invested with the power of effecting any uniformity of time or matter among them.
Are these points clear to us? Let's
it's basically
on.
The establishment of Roman Catholicism, because the whole of the church is basically composed of church and state. And so that's basically what he's describing there.
And what did Trump say yesterday regarding Thanksgiving? What did he say?
Trump calls for national healing on Thanksgiving.
So notice now, national healing on what? Thanksgiving. What two things come together to bring forward Thanksgiving Day, proclaiming Thanksgiving Day? It's church
and state.
Mm-hmm. So in order now to heal the wounds in society,
of the nation,
we
national.
Must use a fruit whose seed is a union of church and state. Go to John 6 with me. Let's bring this to a close, friends. John 6. And that's why we have from Thanksgiving to Sunday.
You know, it's just for government authorities, presidents, to assume that authority of declaring a day holy. I mean, God, we know from Scripture that God is the only one that declares a day holy. And in Scripture, when we find men trying to proclaim days holy, we see that in Exodus 32 with Aaron, when he set up the golden calf, which was a symbol of sun worship. He proclaimed a feast day. He established a feast day to the Lord. He established a religious holiday that was connected with sun worship. He was not given that authority to appoint a day as holy. God gave us the Sabbath day. Jeroboam did the same thing.
In 1 Kings,
and he was worshiping a calf as well. And again, the calf is connected to sun worship. So we can see when a man assumes the authority to take upon himself, the authorization to declare a day holy, it leads to sun worship, is what I'm trying to say.
And what we're seeing here, friends, the national Sunday law is near, very near. And it's only those who give God the true Thanksgiving offering are going to be preserved and are going to make it through this coming crisis. Do not take these studies lightly. Now, the Bible tells us in chapter 13 of Revelation that once the Sunday law is enforced, you know, and before I go there, because someone may say, but Pastor, they have been proclaiming Thanksgiving Day for centuries, decades, and we have not seen a Sunday law yet. Is that your strongest argument against the prophecies of chapter 13 and 14 of Revelation? That since they have been doing this for decades and no Sunday law, it may never happen? Is that your strongest argument? Well, let me tell you something. If you bring a pail or a bucket and put that pail or bucket under a faucet, even if it's one drop, two drops, at some point, if the bucket stays there and the water keeps trickling and dropping in that basin is going to be filled to the brim. So even though these things are happening for decades, it is coming. And other events show us a crisis is nearing on the horizon. Wake up, friend. And chapter 13 of Revelation, let's go there now. Verse 15 through verse 17, God's word says we won't be able to buy or sell. That means we are going to find ourselves in great need. We can eat, we can buy or sell. So we want to look at some text now, some scriptures that would give us encouragement to stand in this coming crisis. In John chapter 6, these people were following Christ for approximately 3 days. He was ministering to them for approximately 3 days, the 5,000. And when it came time for them to eat, there was nothing for them to eat. typifying the Sunday law crisis for those who stand for God faithfully. And the Bible tells us that Christ took a boy's lunch, a boy's lunch that was only for a young boy.
Mm-hmm.
It says he took it, and the first thing he did was to bless it and give thanks. Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
So he thanked God the Father for what he already had.
Mm-hmm.
And as he began to break it now, as he was willing to share now, what happened?
It was multiplied.
And fed how many people?
5,000.
All right. So God is showing us when this event comes, the mark of the beast crisis, and we won't be able to buy or sell if we just give God thanks. Our bread and our water will be sure. The thanks that we're talking about is not the mere, oh Lord, thank you for this day. That's not what we have been studying.
Mm-mm.
The thanksgiving through the sanctuary. Number one, bringing the oil. Dear God, I thank you for the Holy Spirit. You bring the unleavened bread. Thank you for giving me victory over sin. I would not choose to serve men. I will honor your commandment. And then cutting out the fat. And then waving the breast, the heart of God, surrendering sins and consecration, your bread and your water will be sure.
You know, Pastor, as you said that, it's interesting because we see the opposite of those. We see the other class in Revelation 13 when this crisis passed, or when this crisis comes to pass, rather. We see that it is for bread and water, for food that they will receive the mark of the beast.
Well,
you know, she.
Maranatha.
No, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Amen. Maranatha 1:6-2. Human laws will be made so
stringent
that men and women would not dare observe the seventh day Sabbath for fear of wanting food and clothing.
Mm-hmm.
They would join with the world in transgressing God's laws. Philippians chapter 4. Write down these encouraging statements as we bring this to a close. From Thanksgiving to Sunday. We are here, my friends. Philippians chapter 4. Look now at verse number 6 and verse number 7. And look at the connection with thanksgiving and the peace offering.
Hmm.
We have come full circle. Verse 6, verse 7. Hillary?
Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Psalm 116. Let's take one more. These are encouraging scriptures. Psalm 116. Look here at verse number 12. What has God done for you, friends? Look at verse 12. Psalm 116, verse 12 says, what shall I render? What shall I give unto the Lord for all his benefits toward me? Skip on down to verse number 17. I will do what? I will
offer to thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving.
Wow.
And will call upon the name of the Lord.
So what is a sacrifice of thanksgiving, or the thanksgiving sacrifice, the thanksgiving offering?
Mm-hmm.
So for all what God has done for me, today I want to give him the thanksgiving offering, the oil, the unleavened bread, cutting out the fat, and
giving my heart
to him for all that God has done for you. What will you also give God? Will you give God the thanksgiving offering? Will you?
Amen.
Go to Psalm 107. Go to Psalm 107. Write down these texts, my friends. Psalm 107. Hillary, verse 1, verse 2. What has God done for you, friends? Will you give him the thanksgiving offering? Will you, friends? Will you? Psalm 107. Verse 1, verse 2, what it says.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy.
Giving him that thanksgiving offering. Mm-hmm. Go to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse number 14 says, very potent scripture. It says, now, thanks be unto God, which always.
Praise God.
Friends, underscore the word always. Which always causeth us to triumph in Christ. and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place.
You know, our theme for this evening was from Thanksgiving to Sunday. Of course, this is the counterfeit Thanksgiving that leads to Sunday worship. But we can say the genuine Thanksgiving leads to salvation, leads to the seal of God.
Amen. Luke 17, our closing scripture. Luke 17, go there with me. Luke chapter 17, and look with me at verse number 12. Now, in Luke 17 and verse number 12, we see an experience, an account with the 10 lepers. The 10 lepers. And we all know the story. In closing, let's analyze the story. So these 10 lepers, they stood afar off. Christ is passing through. And they said to him, Jesus, Master, have mercy upon us. Mm-hmm. And Christ bade them draw near. And he said, go and show yourselves to the priest. Mm. What happened? They got up and they went. And it says, while they went, they were cleansed. Stop right there. Now, that means when they walked off, they were still with leprosy. Mm-hmm. But as they walked in the strength of the word.
Walking by faith.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. That's it. They were healed.
As they walked in the strength of the word. Walking by faith and not by
sight.
Friends, will you grab that today? Mm-hmm. While they went, they were cleansed. And on the way, before they got to the priest, on the way, one of them realized he was what?
He was healed.
And made a U-turn. Mm-hmm. And went back to find Jesus.
Right.
And when he came, look now at verse number 15. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back. And with a loud voice did what?
Glorified God.
The first
angel's message.
Mm-hmm. Look at this. And fell down on his what?
On his face.
Watch this. Did he cut out the fat?
Oh, yes,
he did.
Was
he surrendering?
Yes.
Look at this.
Yes.
And fell down on his face at Christ's feet. Doing what now? Giving him thanks. And he was a who?
A Samaritan.
Samaritan. Look at this now. And Jesus, answering, said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9?
Hmm.
There are not found that return to give glory to God, save this who?
Stranger.
So now, was this a stranger who was healed?
Yes.
Then verse 19, and he said unto him, arise, go thy
way.
Go where now? Go to the priest?
No.
No. Go thy way. Go and share your testimony. Thy faith hath made thee whole.
Oh,
now, friends, pardon me here. I see an application here. And tell me if you see it. 10 lepers. 9 were healed from leprosy, but did not return to give God the
glory.
Thanksgiving offering. Got it?
Mm-hmm.
One returned. Gave God thanks. Thanksgiving offering. He surrendered. And Christ now says, go thy way. This suggests the 9 were healed but not saved.
Mm-hmm.
Let that sink in. 9 were healed for a time but did not return to give God thanks. In other words, they were healed but did not keep that connection.
Mm.
You're not hearing.
Perhaps they went back to the past lifestyle that they were delivered from.
Yes, they were once healed. And if you juxtapose the 9 who were healed and the one who was also healed but returned to connect himself to Christ, you can see, wait a minute, he had a long-lasting connection, but not the other 9 that did not come back.
Right, right.
Didn't come back.
Wow.
They went to men.
Mm.
They went to men, but the other, the stranger, the Samaritan, he returned to connect himself to Christ. Do you know why? Because maybe going to even the men, they would have polluted him.
Wow. Wow.
With spiritual leprosy.
Reinfected him.
Because they were just to go to testify of somebody who could heal leprosy. Somebody who was above sin. Because leprosy was the disease that could not be healed by
man. Right. Mm-hmm.
But he is one who can heal all diseases. They went to men. But this one came and connected himself to God. So friends,
God,
in closing, which one of these lepers are you this evening? Which one? Which one will you be from this time forward? Because all have sinned. Isaiah chapter 1 says we all have putrefying sores from the crown of our heads to the soles of our feet. Which one will you be? Will you come this evening and give God a thanksgiving offering, understanding that it's by faith you can be healed? If the word says, go, you're healed, then we can walk with that strength this evening. Not worrying about external evidences, but you're walking by faith and not by sight. Do you want this experience this evening? Will you connect yourselves to Christ? Unbroken communion with Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a Savior we have. What can wash away my sins?
Nothing
but the blood of Jesus. What can make me pure within? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, for that flow.
Precious is that flow.
Oh, that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Shall we pray this evening? Father in heaven, we thank you for this brief study. Thanksgiving offering through the sanctuary and how it relates to how people are living their lives as one of the LGBT individuals because they are unthankful, not giving you a Thanksgiving offering. We thank you for showing us the connection between the Thanksgiving proclamation and how similarly there's going to be a proclamation for a Sunday law crisis. Help us, dear God, to give you that Thanksgiving offering now, that we may be healed, preserved, protected in this coming crisis. We thank you for your many blessings. Save us, we pray. We who were once strangers can now become fellow citizens of heaven. We thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercies. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
I want to thank you all for joining us this evening for our Thursday evening.